Hi, Mom. What are you doing today?
Providence Place, owned by the Sisters of Providence, an ideal rental setting for retirees to continue their active, independent lifestyles. We have bright 1 and 2 bedroom apartments, a magnificent chapel with daily mass, restaurant-style dining, and wellness and entertainment programs. Call for a tour, 413-534-9700.
Mom, call me when you're not so busy.
Good morning, friends, and welcome to the Chalice of Salvation, coming to you from the Holy Spirit Chapel in Springfield. I'm your Chalice host, Passionist Brother Terrence Scanlon. The Gospel today reminds us of our ultimate end, which is to be with Jesus in the heavenly realm. As a sign of this, we witness the transfiguration, a visual manifestation of God's blessing on Jesus. Today, we welcome Father Douglas McGonigal, pastor of Our Lady of the Valley Parish in East Hampton, as our Mass celebrant. He is joined by members of his parish as our celebration of the second Sunday of Lent. Our Mass intention is offered in loving memory of Angeline and John Loftus. Members of the family have requested this intention and also join us this day. Jennifer Gaffney from Sacred Heart Parish here in Springfield will be our music minister. We offer our heartfelt good wishes to all who are celebrating birthdays or anniversaries today and throughout the coming week. And friends, a very special shout out to Marie Renaud, who celebrates her birthday today. We miss her presence with us, but extend our heartfelt greetings for a very special day. And I might add a request for your prayers for my classmates, Brother Edward Hall, Father Paul Wierichs, and yours truly, as we celebrate our 56th year as professed Passionist Religious on this very day, March 8th. We appreciate your prayers. Keep them coming. We also remember and pray for those who are ill or homebound, especially those who watch this telecast from your hospital rooms and nursing homes. We pray for you and for those who care for you. And friends, you will note that our congregation today will be following Bishop's recent directives in light of the coronavirus outbreak. And so we will not be having the sign of peace, and communion will be only the consecrated host and not the chalice. We pray for the countless people here in the United States and around the world infected by this terrible virus, and we pray for those caring for them. We also remember the names that you, our viewing community, have sent in today for the Book of Remembrance. May the souls of all the faithfully departed know God's peace and loving mercy. And following our liturgy, Steve Katonic will share his interview last year with Father Douglas McGonigal on his lifelong interest in space exploration. That's right after our liturgy. We now join our congregation and welcome Father Douglas McGonigal as together we celebrate the second Sunday of Lent.
Remember your compassion, O Lord, and your merciful love for those are from of old. Let not your enemies exult over us. Redeem us, O God of Israel, from all our distress. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask, Blessed Mary, Ever-Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Amen.
Kyrie eleison.
Kyrie eleison.
Christe eleison.
Christe eleison.
Kyrie eleison. Let us pray. O God, who have commanded us to listen to your beloved Son, be pleased, we pray, to nourish us inwardly by your word, that with spiritual sight made pure, we may rejoice to behold your glory. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Genesis. The Lord said to Abram, "Go forth from the land of your kinsfolk and from your father's house to a land that I will show you. I will make of you a great nation, and I will bless you. I will make your name great so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you and curse those who curse you. All the communities of the earth shall find blessing in you." Abram went as the Lord directed him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let your mercy be on us, O God, as we place our trust in you. Let your mercy be on us, O God, as we fills all creation. Let your mercy be on us, O God, as we place our trust in you. See how the eye of God is watching, ever guarding all who wait in hope, to deliver them from sustain them in times of famine. Let your mercy be on us, O God, as we place our trust in you.
A reading from the second letter of St. Paul to Timothy. Beloved, Bear your share of hardship for the gospel with the strength that comes from God. He saved us and called us to a holy life, not according to our works, but according to his own design, and the grace bestowed on us in Christ Jesus before time began, but now made manifest through the appearance of our Savior, Christ Jesus, who destroyed death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Glory and praise to you, O Lord Jesus Christ. Glory and praise to you, O Lord Jesus Christ. You have stilled our hearts, and now we listen to your word.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord.
Jesus took Peter, James, and John, his brother, and led them up a high mountain by themselves. And he was transformed before them. His face shone like the sun, and his clothes became white as light. And behold, Moses and Elijah appeared to them, conversing with him. Then Peter said to Jesus in reply, "Lord, it is good that we are here. If you wish, I will make three tents here, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." While he was still speaking, behold, a bright cloud cast a shadow over them. Then from the cloud came a voice that said, "This is my beloved Son with whom I am well pleased. Listen to him." When the disciples heard this, they fell prostrate and were very much afraid. But Jesus came and touched them, saying, "Rise and do not be afraid." And when the disciples raised their eyes, they saw no one else but Jesus alone. As they were coming down from the mountain, Jesus charged them, "Do not tell the vision to anyone until the Son of Man has been raised from the dead." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
It's 37 years ago. A strong wind nearly knocks me off my feet. Fatigue makes my legs feel like rubber, and I'm unsure of my footing as I stand upon the smooth rock that slopes downward on all sides. Yet none of this matters to me. I'm a mile high atop Mount Lafayette in the White Mountains of New Hampshire. The panorama which stretches all about me takes my breath away. Mountains surround me and merge into the haze of the distant horizon. Everywhere I look down on the earth. The dome of heaven arches over me, and I feel as though I'm standing on the center of the universe. Suddenly, I know why mountain peaks are such holy places. I understand why God chooses so often to make himself known to us on the tops of mountains, as in today's gospel reading, when Jesus Christ was transfigured before his disciples on a mountaintop. And even though I don't see Elijah or Moses, I know he is standing there with me. So ask yourselves, why do we climb mountains? Think of it. Amongst all of God's creatures, only humans climb mountains for no reason except to experience standing on the summit. Other creatures may climb mountains driven by a search for food, shelter, or safety. We humans, on the other hand, we are driven solely by God's gift of curiosity, driven simply to know what is on the other side. And as all of us know, overcoming a challenge like climbing a mountain helps us to grow. It changes us. We are transformed. In a few moments, that bread and wine on the gift table will be transformed. They will truly and really be transformed into the body and blood, soul and divinity of our Lord Jesus Christ. And if you and I are free from grave sin, then from this altar will flow all the graces we will need to be transformed into holy saints. You see, it is grace that awakens the human in the animal. Without grace, we might simply live our lives driven only by the need for food, shelter, and safety. Grace awakens our human curiosity. It is grace that leads us humans to the tops of mountains where we can look out over the earth below, touch the heavens above, and contemplate the infinite love of the God who created it all. So, as you receive communion today, open yourselves to the grace that the Most Holy Eucharist provides. Allow God's graces to transform you into a holy saint. In addition, if it's been a while since you stood on a mountaintop, then take the time this Lent and go do it. When the snow is melted, go and make a hike up the Hadley Range or out in the Berkshires. And if your hiking days are far behind you, then head over to Skinner State Park in Hadley and drive up the auto road to the Summit House. Or on Mount Holyoke and head to South Deerfield and drive up Mount Sugarloaf, or drive up the Summit Road at Mount Greylock in the Berkshires. Remember, all work and no play not only makes you very dull, it also makes you very, very dead. If we do these things, if we take the time to enjoy God's creation, if we open our hearts to the graces flowing from this altar by confessing our sins, then we will reach the summit. We will reach heaven, and our Lord Jesus Christ will welcome us with open arms. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate, he suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Let us place our trust in God as we offer our prayers for the needs of the world around us.
Our response this morning for the petitions will be, Lord, hear us. For the church, that we may be transformed in God's image and shine the light of Christ to the whole world through our works of mercy and charity, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear us.
That all communities of the earth may find blessing in God through the way they care for the hungry at the table, the homeless in the street, the refugee at the border, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear us.
In looking forward to the transfigured Jesus, we may be strengthened in our resolve to follow him more closely, and that all attending the Catholic Life Conference may find in Jesus renewed hope and joy, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear us.
For women on International Women's Day, that they be treated with respect and their voices may be heard in all places in our community, all communities in our nation, and all nations throughout the world, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear us.
We remember this day Angeline and John Loftus, for whom this Mass is being offered, and for the names that we now enter into our Book of Remembrance this day, let us pray to the Lord.
Lead us now, join in the communal prayer, which we all have copies. In celebration of the 150th anniversary of our diocese, let us now pray the celebration prayer. Our faith in you, dear Lord, has carried our diocesan community of believers for 150 years. Mindful of your steadfast presence, we commit ourselves again to your wisdom and guidance. From the overflowing spring of your goodness, bless our resolve to serve you and one another. You have always sustained us in the past. Graciously accompany all that we do today, and so be with us forever as you unfold our future. Amen.
Again from ashes, from the good we failed to do. We rise again from ashes to create ourselves anew. If all our world is ashes, then must our lives be true? Give our visions wider view. then rise again from ashes. Let healing come to pain. Though spring has turned to winter and sunshine turned to rain, the rain will use for growing to create.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and all of his holy church.
May the sacrifice, O Lord, we pray, cleanse us of our faults and sanctify your faithful in body and mind, for the celebration of the Paschal festivities, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, through Christ our Lord. For after he had told his disciples of his coming death, on the holy mountain he manifested to them his glory, to show even by the testimony of the law and the prophets that the passion leads to the glory of the resurrection. And so with the powers of heaven, we worship you constantly on earth and before your majesty without end we acclaim.
Holy, holy, Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest, blessed is he.
You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy, and you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, For this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me. Mysterium Fidei.
We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again, until you come again.
Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and with all the saints on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May the sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth with your servants, Francis, our Pope, and Mitchell, our Bishop, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good.
Through him and with him and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever.
At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you. Look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Lamb of God, you take away the sins of
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Pleased. Listen to him. The body of Christ.
Beyond the days of hope and mystery, we see a light of faith renewed, and in a longing we thirst for guidance to walk with you day by day. Forty days and nights you guide the steps of our journey. May your presence be felt in the whisper of your voice. We see a light of faith renewed, and in a longing we thirst for guidance to walk with you day by day. Not on bread alone are we to walk on this journey. To the yearnings of our hearts. Beyond the days of hope and mystery, we see a light of faith renewed, and in a longing we thirst for guidance to walk with you. Of your guidance, keep us safe in your care. May your gentleness be there. Beyond the days of hope and mystery, we see a light of faith renewed, and we thirst for guidance to walk with you day by day.
The Missal. Let us pray. As we receive these glorious mysteries, we make thanksgiving to you, O Lord, for allowing us, while still on earth, to be partakers even now of the things of heaven, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And
bow your heads and pray for God's blessing. Bless your faithful, we pray, O Lord, with a blessing that endures forever, and keep them faithful to the gospel of your only begotten Son,
so that they may always desire and at last attain that glory whose beauty he showed in his own body to the amazement of his apostles, through Christ our Lord. Okay. And may Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go forth, this Mass is ended.
All of us have heard of the coronavirus that is afflicting the world and has come to the shores of our own nation. As a church, we too join with so many other entities in taking precautions so that the coronavirus is not spread. And so in this season of the coronavirus and of the flu, I am issuing guidelines for churches so that we may do all that we can to prevent the spread of the coronavirus. These guidelines include removing the holy water from the fonts so that no germs can breed there, of not issuing the cup, the chalice, at Mass, and of being able to refrain from the sign of peace. In doing so, we're hoping that these measures will help us as we go through this difficult time to prevent any spread of the coronavirus. I urge you too to take local precautions in your homes and in your workplaces with the washing of hands frequently so that any germs can be removed. Thank you for your cooperation, and let us all be on high alert and aware of the coronavirus and of being as hygienic as possible. Thank you, and God bless you.
Hi, Mom. What are you doing today?
Providence Place, owned by the Sisters of Providence, an ideal rental setting for retirees to continue their active, independent lifestyles. We have bright 1 and 2 bedroom apartments, a magnificent chapel with daily mass, restaurant-style dining, and wellness and entertainment programs. Call for a tour, 413-534-9700.
Mom, Call me when you're not so busy.
Just over 50 years ago, people around the world gazed to the heavens as American astronauts were heading for a historic rendezvous with the moon. Father Douglas McGonigal was one of the millions who watched as Neil Armstrong took his first steps on the lunar surface. Steve Katonic sat down with Father Doug, who has earned a PhD in astronomy, and spoke with him about space, the moon landing, and its impact on the world.
It began with a challenge by President John F. Kennedy speaking before a special joint session of Congress.
I believe that this nation should commit itself to achieving the goal before this decade is out of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to the earth.
JFK's bold national call to action would change the world. America met the challenge head on. For the next 7 years, NASA focused all its effort to the fulfillment of that pledge. First with the Mercury program, then Gemini, and finally the Apollo program. It all culminated on July 16, 1969, when the massive 30-story, 6-million-pound Saturn V rocket lifted off from the Kennedy Space Center in Florida. On board were three astronauts, Commander Neil Armstrong, Lunar Module Pilot Edwin Buzz Aldrin, and Command Module Pilot Michael Collins. After 4 days and a 238,900-mile journey, the crew of Apollo 11 reached their final destination, the moon.
Tranquility Base here. The Eagle has landed.
On July 20, 1969, an estimated 600 million people, one-fifth the world's population at the time, collectively held its breath, watched, and listened as Neil Armstrong descended the steps of the Eagle Lunar Module and jumped off onto the lunar surface.
That's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
It was the first time a human had set foot on a surface other than Earth. Buzz Aldrin soon joined him, and both men explored the barren landscape for several hours, conducting experiments, gathering rocks, and planting the American flag.
Yes, indeed. They've got the flag up now, and you can see the stars and stripes on the lunar surface.
Beautiful, just beautiful.
After nearly a day, the lunar module blasted off from the Sea of Tranquility. The astronauts left behind a plaque with the words,
"Dear men from the planet Earth, first set foot upon the moon, July 1969, AD. We came in peace for all mankind."
They rendezvoused with the mothership piloted by Collins, who was in orbit around the moon. 4 days later, Apollo 11 splashed down safely in the Pacific Ocean. President Richard Nixon greeted them, claiming that week to be the greatest week in the history of the world since creation. The astronauts received a hero's welcome with ticker tape parades like this one in Houston, and later going on a 22-nation world tour. This year marks the 50th anniversary of that historic landing. In Billerica, Massachusetts, a then 10-year-old Douglas McGonigal looked on in amazement with his family. He would later become Father Douglas McGonigal, the pastor of Our Lady of the Valley Parish. He was fascinated by space and space exploration from an early age.
I've, you know, always had an interest, never known a time when I didn't.
Father Doug was born in 1959, right after the Russians had launched the Sputnik satellite, triggering the U.S.-Soviet space race.
It was a period of time where, you know, your Cheerios boxes had pictures of astronauts and Chuck Yeager and all those people, and science and space and rockets and airplanes and electronics were just, it was what you ate, you know, what you breathed all the time.
His father worked in the high-tech industry for General Dynamics Research, where he and other engineers developed optical components for the Mercury space capsule.
Living in eastern Massachusetts, you know, a lot of the technology was being developed there, you know, and a lot of people I lived around, the engineers, the dads of my friends were all engineers working on some parts of these projects. So it was all in the air.
On that historic day, McGonigal was glued with his two brothers to a GE portable TV set, the kind with the rabbit ears that got only 12 channels.
I remember my brothers and I were sitting on the living room floor watching this black and white TV and these fuzzy images, you know, and trying to figure out exactly what it was you're looking at. The actual TV transmissions, you know, the blown out, you know, the contrast was awful, the transmission wasn't all that good, but yeah, you know, you could figure out something was happening.
As his family watched the moon landing, McGonigal knew the risks involved. The Apollo program began in tragedy on January 27, 1967, when a fire broke out inside the Apollo 1 command module during a pre-flight test at Cape Canaveral, killing all three astronauts, Edwin White, Virgil Gus Grissom, and Roger Chaffee.
We knew that the smallest little thing, you know, could be a death sentence for these people. So I think that was, I think what I remember more about it is just how brave these guys had to be.
The lunar landing was not without its religious connections. Buzz Aldrin, a Presbyterian minister, received permission to bring bread and wine on the mission. Before he walked on the lunar surface, Aldrin gave himself communion. He felt strongly that as man explores space, we are in fact acting in Christ. During a radio blackout, Aldrin quoted scripture, "I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever remains in me and I in him will bear much fruit, for you can do nothing without me." Pope Paul VI was known as an admirer of space travel. As the moon landing took place, he watched as it occurred through the Schmidt telescope at the Vatican Observatory in Castel Gandolfo, Italy. The pontiff was one of 75 world leaders who penned messages for the astronauts to leave behind on the moon, writing, "For the glory of the name of God, who gives men such power, we pray and wish well for this wondrous endeavor." 3 months after the landing, the astronauts and their wives were invited to the Vatican, where they received gifts symbolic of the Magi, noting that the wise men were also guided by the stars. Father McGonigal never lost his childhood wonder and interest in space. He eventually earned a bachelor's and doctoral degree in astronomy from the University of Massachusetts Amherst in 1995. His dissertation, The Chemistry of the Interstellar Medium. His specialty, radio astronomy. Father Doug became one of the founding members and president of the Amherst Area Amateur Astronomers Association. He worked on large-scale wave telescopes as a postdoctoral fellow before entering Pope John National Seminary. He was ordained in June 2000 and became pastor of Our Lady of the Valley Parish in 2010. The lunar landing remains one of humankind's greatest achievements.
I think it's a moment in time that may never, ever happen again.
Father McGonigal cited the JFK assassination and 9/11 as comparable moments in history that almost everyone remembers.
But both those events happened unexpectedly. They were traumatic, memorizing, life-changing. But here, the moon landing, everybody knew when it was going to happen, at just the right time where most everybody on the planet had access to the information, could see what was happening or hear it or listen about it or, you know, get a report about it instantaneously. And so there was an appointment and the whole planet paused, you know, for those few moments as they stepped out on the moon.
The 50th anniversary has revived interest in America's space program and of returning to the moon. Father McGonigal believes that we, as a race, are going back to the moon and then eventually onto Mars. But who gets there next is anyone's guess. China, India, and Israel have all expressed a desire to go to the moon. And billionaires like Amazon's Jeff Bezos and independent SpaceX's Elon Musk are already light years ahead of some countries.
And their playground is now spaceships and stuff, and they're pushing the technology faster than any government could ever do because they can take risks, it's their money.
From 1960 until 1972, when the Apollo program ended, about $24 billion was spent on space, which is close to $100 billion in today's dollars. Many technological advances were made during the lunar mission decade, including computer microchips, solar panels, and GPS navigation. Despite talk of the space program being too expensive and labor-intensive, it took 400,000 engineers to get to the moon. Father McGonigal believes reaching for the stars is programmed in our DNA.
There's no choice for the human being not to explore, not to ask questions, not to. It's the same way as saying, you know, what use is a symphony? Symphony doesn't have to justify itself. Neither does man's need for exploration.
As the anniversary approached, Father Doug went on a mission to find an exact replica of the Ravel Saturn V model rocket that he built as a youth.
As a 10-year-old, I did my best to build it and had great fun doing so. Well, now I'm 60 years old and doing a really good job on midlife crisis and all that sort of stuff. And it popped into my head, gee, I'd love to build that model.
After years searching the internet, Father Doug finally tracked down the model in England. With shipping, it cost $150. For this astronomer priest, it was well worth it. He plans to build the model with a fellow priest, Father Piotr Paulus of Hadley. In the process, Father Doug hopes to maybe relive a special moment from his youth, a time when things were simpler and perhaps more awe-inspiring.
We choose to go to the moon. We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other things, not because they are easy, but because they are hard. Because that goal will serve to organize and measure the best of our energies and skills. Because that challenge is one that we're willing to accept.
Thanks, Steve, for that insightful interview. And I want to thank Father Douglas McGonigal for celebrating our liturgy today, and we extend our prayers and blessings to all in his parish community. We sincerely thank Jennifer Gaffney for sharing her gift of music with us. We are indeed most grateful to her. Friends, our annual Catholic Appeal is underway with its theme, Our Faith, Our Future. Please consider giving to the major fundraiser effort which touches the lives of so many people throughout our diocesan communities. Because of your kindness, we here at Chalice have continued this weekly televised Mass since 1957, 63 years. And for this, we are most grateful. You can make your donation through your parish, or even better yet, right now by logging on to diocesespringfield.org, look for the annual Catholic Appeal logo. And from all of us here at Chalice of Salvation, we thank you in advance. And please pray for the annual Catholic Appeal's success. And asking you to join us again next week for your Childless of Salvation program as we welcome the Fourth Degree Knights of Columbus and Father Jeffrey Blue as our Mass presider. That's next week, right here on the Childless of Salvation, your spiritual connection. In the name of all of us here at Chalice, we thank you for your prayerful support. And please know that you are always in our prayers. Love to all. See you next Sunday.